Hello, I'm Dean Martin with Transmission Digest. Welcome to the Transtar Industry Studios here at Babcock's Media.
Welcome back to the 8L 45 and 90 presentation. So far, we've removed the valve body, stator support, and pump case cover, as well as the rotating clutches. There's actually a bearing and steel shim. It's not selective, but this has to go between the C3 drum and the stator support. And we're going to go ahead and take the a piston out of this. Also, in between the C4, C5, and C3 clutch drum is a similar setup to where you have a steel race as well as a bearing on top of it. Make sure that those are in and in correctly. There are also two cage bearings that go into each drum, the C3 drum, as well as the C4, C5 drum. This is actually the clutch hub for the C3 clutch, and this shaft goes all the way down through to the output planetary sun gear. There is actually only one bonded piston in this transmission, believe it or not, so all of the other pistons merely require D-rings or O-rings, so that reduces the cost to rebuild this.
There you go, Mike.
Okay, thanks. Okay, on the C3, you just have a normal metal retainer. It has a spring set, but this spring set actually has a plastic divider that you want to make sure you put it in the right direction, because if you flip it the other way, it could inhibit how much this will compress. So make sure that this gets installed the correct way with the legs facing down. Again, it just has a normal aluminum piston. Not a big deal. And one thing you want to be careful of, this is your input sensor reluctor. Make sure it doesn't get banged to where it could create a signal problem. And the input shaft does come out. It's held in by a snap ring in case you have to change it. You got it?
I got it.
Okay. The first thing to come out, this is actually for the C5 clutch, and this is a fairly elaborate setup. Okay, and go ahead and pop this one out. Because down inside of it is the C4. A couple of things you have to watch for. This is actually a dam, and again, it's got D-rings and O-rings. This is where your return spring goes. Make sure that the return spring gets installed the right way, because it can go in upside down. So it goes in with the dish up. And that's what provides the return of the piston. It does have an inner piston, and this can actually go in upside down as well and be wrong. So make sure that when you take this apart, it gets installed correctly, or it could have a problem with application. And again, this piston is what applies the C4 clutch. And the same thing, it has a Belleville spring. You have to make sure you install correctly or you could have a problem. And this is a stationary dam that is used on many late model transmissions. Again, this has certain tangs, notches to enable you to put it down in the drum correctly. Okay, now that we have the rotating clutches out of the way, we can start pulling out some of the planetary components. As I said, there's four planetary sets. The first one is the, we'll go ahead and pull them all. The first one is the direct overdrive. The second one is the input planetary. The third is the reaction planetary. And the fourth is the output planetary. And GM did a real good job making this a compacted, nested assembly. There are primarily thrust bearings throughout. A lot of them are captured, which means you can't replace them. On this input planetary and shell, there are actually two different plastic washers. They decided to use plastic instead of thrust bearings on this. But also, right on top of the number two, number three sun gear, there is a spacer which is made out of like a Torlon or Vespel type material. It can only go one way. Make sure it gets installed, because this also is a thrust surface.
Here in our center support is our only bonded piston. Everything else, D-ring and O-ring.
And this is actually where the K-seal hits. Make sure that K-seal is in there, or you're going to have big time problems. And this stationary brake is for the C1 clutch. And as Anthony said, this is the only bonded piston in here. It does have an apply ring that sets on top of it, as well as a Belleville. And the same thing, make sure the Belleville gets installed the correct way, which means the dish goes up. The direct overdrive sun gear is actually splined to the input ring gear. And the C1 clutch hub actually connects to the input sun gear and reaction sun gear, which are one assembly. On the C1 clutch, you actually have an apply plate as well as a backing plate, and then you have your normal frictions and steels, so make sure that the apply plate gets installed the right way. And the last stationary brake is a C2 stationary brake, and that has to come out through the front side. So the very first thing you want to install when you go back together is the C2 clutch pack. And you can load from the back and then put the rest of the stuff in from in the front. As I mentioned, the C2 clutch pack has a waste spring, an apply plate, as well as the normal frictions and steels. For some reason, the clutch hub on this is aluminum. And it also has the reaction ring gear splined to it. So there could be wear issues long term on these clutch hubs. So always check to make sure that they're not worn. And this is the reaction carrier. Again, it's got captured bearings, and this is the output carrier. Also has a captured bearing on the front and back side, and believe it or not, this is the output sun gear, which is fairly small. I wanted to mention there are two bushings down inside of this. If these bushings are bad, probably going to have to replace the carrier, because you can't get them out unless these gears are pulled and the bearings pulled out of the way, which requires ripping out this dam bearing. It might be fairly difficult to get these gears out just to replace the two bushings. But that's how it was made. This is also a center ring for the output sensor, and this is the center ring for the intermediate sensor. So again, make sure that these don't get damaged. And we're going to go ahead and pull the rear plate, whether it's a two-wheel drive, four-wheel drive.
Before Mike starts talking about this, I wanted to point out the pressure taps. The C2 and the line pressure tap are at the bottom of the transmission here.
Yeah, GM finally made it somewhat easy to test pressure, so you don't have to go in between the floorboard. You can go right to the bottom. Again, this tall piston is what applies the C2 clutch. The output shaft on these models are actually interchangeable. So you can use a two-wheel drive, a four-wheel drive, a VET. They all merely spline in to the output planetary. So it's another fairly decent setup to where you can change shafts and not have to change the entire planet.
The threads inside of this output shaft are 12 by 175. If you guys have ever made a 6L tool to load the planet in, it's the same threads.
In between the intermediate plate and the case, again, is another metal, somewhat reusable type of gasket. Again, it's probably a good idea just to replace this. They always come in the kit anyway. The linkage is fairly standard. It does have a spring-loaded link to hook to the manual valve.
Okay, Mike, I popped out the retaining ring for the C2 piston for you.
Okay. And a similar thing, this has a normal dam, normal return spring, which can go either direction. And as you can see, the piston itself is fairly tall. The C2 as well as the C1 pistons both have air bleeds, so make sure that these air bleeds are open because, of course, if you get air in the circuit and it stays there, it affects the shifting. On this type of adapter plate, there's actually two metal clad seals. You have one external, but there's also one internal, so make sure that both of them get replaced and that they're installed the correct way. And as I said, the planetary setup is a pretty compact arrangement. And just make sure that whatever loose thrust bearings there are, that they're installed correctly. And assembling this is not really too bad. When you put this back together, making sure clutch clearance is right, your overall end play, and the valve body, as I mentioned, making sure that the solenoids are right, and if you have to replace them, go through the reprogramming strategy. We also put a chart in there showing what each solenoid is for. Do you have anything else to add?
I think the last thing I would add, you might have touched on it already, is that updated fluid, the Mobile 1 HP. I believe GM says it's the one in the blue label.
The GM has done several things to try to eliminate converter shutter and so on, and changing fluid, changing torque converters, changing transmissions, reprogramming. There a lot of things have been tried, but as Anthony mentioned, the mobile synthetic HP fluid seems to be working fairly well. So just be sure of what you're working on, and when you go through the unit, it's really not too bad mechanically, but make sure all the programming is done so that there are no other problems. In conclusion, I'm Mike Riley.
I'm Anthony Tosi.
Thanks for watching.
See you next time.